Hi everyone, welcome to my Saturday Night Live session. Today I have with me a very special guest, the ex-Miss Malaysia World 2010, Nadia Heng, and she's going to talk to us about how to improve our public speaking skills. Just give me a minute while I add her in. Just give me a minute while I add Nadia Heng. Hi!
Oh, wait, hang on.
Hi, Nadia.
Give me a second. I just realized, I don't know whether I'm on my right page. Hang on, let me just log out and then come back in. Hang on.
All right, okay. All right, so just a little technical glitch. So everybody who's joining us, we're going to be live with Nadia Heng, a wonderful person. I met her a few months back when we did an event together. And I think it's amazing what she's doing. She's coaching people on how to speak in publicly and how to improve your skills, whether it's a physical. I mean, before this, it was all physical. So now it's all about virtual presentation. So I thought it'd be very interesting to talk to her about the differences between physical speaking, public speaking, as well as virtual public speaking. So let me just add her in once again. Hang on. Go live. Okay. So it'll be interesting to see her point of view.
Hi.
Hi, Nadia.
Hi, Dr. Rakhee.
Thank you so much for joining me. Yes, it's been a while. I was just telling everybody I did an event with you maybe a few months back. Yeah, it was such an interesting event with so many people going on live at the same time. It was a bit overwhelming for me, but you took it in stride and I was amazed by the way you handled everything virtually. I've not seen you go, I mean, on a physical basis, I'm sure it is different. So I thought, what better way, since you're a coach as well in public speaking, I think it's Articulate Community, right?
Yeah.
So since you're a coach and you do community, you teach public speaking, so I thought, what better way than to spend a Saturday night talking to everybody and teaching them a skill that is definitely useful, especially in the current situation where we may not be going back to physical events so soon, but you know, you're in on Zoom and you're in on so many different virtual platforms presenting meetings and all that. So, you know, without further ado, everybody, Nadia Heng, would you like to introduce yourself?
Thank you so much for having me, Dr. Rakhee. First of all, let me just say it is really a pleasure to be able to reconnect with you after like so many months and yes, on a virtual platform, no less. Thank goodness for technology.
Absolutely.
So hello everyone. Thank you for joining us today. So very quickly, just a little bit about myself. As you've mentioned, Dr. Rakhee, yes, I am a professional master of ceremonies. I'm a TV host. And thanks to our last lockdown and this whole pandemic, I've actually gone into coaching and teaching public speaking. So if you want to, feel free to go check out Articulate Communities. So it's where I basically teach one-on-one coaching. I also do buddies. I also do webinars. And hopefully once this lockdown is over, I'll be able to do live group events as well. So yeah, and I also have a digital series coming soon. So that's essentially what I do for work.
Absolutely wonderful. I have seen a few of your tips on your reels and on your IGTV, and I find them very useful. So even to prepare myself on virtual platforms, I mean, some of them, you know, because body gestures, as you can see, you know, we only get to see the head and above. But I think it still makes a huge difference the way you speak and, you know, the way you come across with all your free tips and all. So I think it's very, very helpful to me as well in the past couple of months. So I'm going to get into a few questions with you, and then maybe we'll, if anybody has any questions, please put them up in the comment section and we'll go through them as well. So what are the benefits of good public speaking skills?
The benefits of good public speaking skills, I honestly cannot emphasize them enough, right? I really truly believe that with good public speaking skills, you open up so many new doors of opportunities that you never even knew existed, right? And I say this because personally for myself, I personally used to be very much an introvert. Like in school, I wasn't the one who would go into debates or anything like that. I was always playing safe in numbers, right? I'd always join groups of people. Like I would do choirs, I'd do plays, but predominantly things where there's lots of people involved, right? Now, that's actually, I think, a really good platform to start with. But sooner or later, you realize, you know, as soon as you go into the working world, having the ability to speak and to be able to articulate your ideas well is really what's going to help you not only represent yourself from a personal standpoint, but, you know, as a professional standpoint as well. If you want to grow in your career, right, and if you want to clinch any job opportunities, right, to get promoted, you know, or if you're representing your own brand, if you're an entrepreneur, and you realize as soon as you want your business to go and grow a little bit bigger, the moment you have a media launch that comes up, you know, you start to realize there are so many there's so many avenues, right, in which public speaking is so, so crucial, right? So if you are able to master or at least get comfortable, confident with the very basics of public speaking, all those opportunities are going to be at your fingertips. So what happens is if you don't have it, you basically are putting yourself into a corner, right? And yes, you're never going to be brave enough to take those opportunities, and you're never going to be able to be recognized, right? I mean, let's just take a small example in a meeting, right? Let's say you're having a meeting with partners or with your superiors, and you've got some great ideas, but because you're not confident enough to actually voice out or able to articulate your thoughts in a good manner, you might just be overlooked. And I have this happen with a lot of my students that actually come to me, right? Some of them are, like, let's say, software engineers, or maybe they're in project management and they're looking to take on a bigger role. And they realize that all this while they've kind of just been in the shadows, right? Or like working behind the scenes, which there's nothing wrong with that, yeah, right? But as soon as you want to make more money or try and get that promotion, or maybe you get promoted and you realize suddenly I have all these other responsibilities and I have to lead a team. And then you find yourself, yeah, in a situation where you don't know how to manage it. So, and I see this every day with students, right, who actually come to me for public speaking lessons in order to be able to fill those roles or in order to be able to advance their careers. So, yeah, benefits are endless.
Absolutely. I agree with everything you've just said. They are fantastic points. And yeah, it's fine to be in the shadows as well. But like, I feel sometimes in our Asian culture, we are not taught to vocalize, to, you know, to, when you say something or when you speak out, you're considered authoritative and, oh, that person's kind of rude, you know, why is she saying things? But actually, you're just trying to speak out and you're just trying to be a bit more, you know, on the extrovert side, and you're just trying to get the whatever information that you have within you across in the nicest way. But it's in our Asian culture, I guess, you know, so that's why a lot of us just rather, I'll just stay in the shadows. I'll just join a choir brand. And yeah, so those are fantastic points. So what are the good qualities in someone who's got, or a good speaker? What are the good qualities in a good speaker?
Okay, so I think that being a good speaker is really about, like, what's your objective, right? So at the end of the day, if you even take a small example of being in a business meeting, right? The quality of being a good speaker is being able to, let's say you have information that is valuable, you want to be able to ensure that that information that you have is going to actually be received by your audience. So whether it's 2 people, 10 people, or 1,000 people, your goal as a communicator, to be a good communicator, is to ensure that that message, that value that you hold, is going to actually be able to be channeled to your audience, right? And that they're able to receive it, understand it, digest it, process it, and then be able to take action, right? So if you're not a good communicator, that's not going to happen. So in public speaking, I always tell my students there's 2 elements, right? Or there's 2 parts to it. There's the content side of things. So that means like your messaging, your basically your core message. What is the story that you want to share, the value that you're going to share? And the content also consists of the structure. Like, how good is your structure? Is it going to be something that's just sort of like really messy and you're trying to get it across, or are you going to structure it nicely with good transitions and organize your thoughts, right? Because that makes a huge difference. So your content is one part of it. The other part of public speaking is really down to your delivery. So that means, how are you actually going to use your body language, your facial expressions, and your tonality to get people on board, right? To get people riled up and excited about your idea. So once you combine these 2 elements, right? So your content, your structure, and all of that good stuff, and your delivery, once you can master both of these, that's when you can become a really good communicator, right? Because that ensures that your message is not only going to be of value easy to understand and structured, but ultimately you're going to be able to get people excited about it, right? Have that infectious enthusiasm and get people on board your idea. So I think those are the qualities of a good speaker. Yeah.
Absolutely. So besides joining and getting you as a coach, are there any ways that we can do to improve ourselves, our public speaking abilities? Anything that you could maybe tell us on?
Sure. So, I mean, I think that, of course, there are many, many ways that you can go about it, right? The easiest one, of course, is if you do get a coach, you have some, you have sort of the shortcuts where someone can actually monitor and show you and tell you and guide you, right? But of course, there are so, like, you know, we live in the digital age, so that's like a real blessing. So if you have the patience to do it, the first thing I would recommend, like, let's say you want to improve on your public speaking skills, is to actually know and assess how good you are at the moment, right? So that means actually taking your device, you know, taking your mobile phone and recording yourself. So if you record yourself presenting, watch it back. And I know a lot of my students hate doing this. They're like, no, I don't want to see myself talking. Right? We hate the sound of our own voice. We hate how we look. Yeah. It's normal. Like we all feel like this. Have you ever watched yourself back, Dr. Rakhee? Have you ever done that?
Oh my God. Yes, I have. I was just going to say, I was supposed to take, I think it was a 3-minute clip of myself saying something about vaccines. And sending it up to this person who had sent it to me. And I had to do like 10 takes. And in between, I kept laughing at myself. And when I looked at my video, I was like, oh my God, why do I look like that? Oh no. Oh God, the English is horrible. Did I say too many ums? Did I say too many ahs? Okay, let's retake again. So I literally took, I think, an hour to send a 2-minute video clip, you know, because I wanted it to be perfect. And, you know, I didn't want like, you know, some phone to ring in the meantime, and you know, and your voice didn't sound too squeaky. Okay, let me control my voice. Let me control the tone. So yeah, absolutely right. It's horrendous to look at yourself after that. Yeah, it's true. It's true.
But you know, the good news is that we all feel like how you felt in that moment, watching it back and assessing. We all feel the same way. But you know, it's actually one of the crucial first steps. So like, let's say you know, if you want to just learn and practice and persevere and do it on your own, that's the best way you can do it. Like, record yourself, watch it back, and then break it down. So as I mentioned, you know, there's two parts to public speaking. You have the content side and the structure, and then on the other side is delivery, right? So then what you want to do is you want to assess everything. So you're going to assess, okay, how was my content, first of all, right? Was the message that I was giving, was it relevant? Was it actually of benefit or of value? Ask yourself that question. Yeah. Secondly, you want to ask yourself, how organized were my thoughts? Was I all over the place, or was it very clear when I transitioned, you know, from my introduction? Did I make it very clear in my headline what my topic is about? And then as you listen back to it, was it clear that I was transitioning from the first point to the second point, and so on and so forth, right? So if you analyze what, you know, your own speech that way, it will give you a really good indication of where your weak points are and what you need to improve on. And the same applies for like your delivery. So if you talk about watching it back, and this is the part which people usually like cringe and like, oh my God, I look so stupid. But this is super important, right? Because when you do this, you're going to discover so, you know, basically you're going to find a gold mine of information. You're going to be able to see, oh shoots, you know, you realize maybe the whole time when you're presenting, you're standing hunched, right? And all of us do this when we're like, especially if you're not brought up with great posture, and no one reminds you, when you watch it back, that's one of the first things a lot of students realize, is that when they're standing up, their head is like perched forward and they're like hunched back. And so, you know, you'll spot things like that. Or maybe you'll realize that you're not even looking at the camera, you know?
So
all of these things really help you refine and figure out, okay, where my weaknesses are. So once you've identified that, that's when you can start to improve. So let's just say you realize, okay, my content was all over the place. And maybe you realize that you are not looking at the camera or smiling. Maybe you have this like resting, you know, RBF face. Right? Or you might realize that I'm just standing there stiff, like super kaku with my hands by my side, right? Yes. So if you identify these three things, then you know, okay, these are the things I need to work on. And so from here, you can start to figure out, okay, if my content and my structure was messy, then you want to actually make sure that you spend more time doing your research, doing more writing, and like sifting through your ideas, filtering them through. And so one way you can do this that's really good to make sure your content is not messy is by following a very simple structure, right? So that means that in your speech, you're going to follow a speech framework, which I do teach my students as well, to make sure that every sentence that you have in your speech is going to be of value, right? So the key thing in speeches and content, which is a really good tip that I can share, is to make sure that your content is nice and lean, right? You want to cut out all the fat and keep your content really nice and lean. Because, you know, in school, tell me if this is true, Dr. Rakhee, and you guys who are watching too, please let me know if you agree with me. I think in school, we put far too much emphasis on like the longer, the more panjang your essay, the more words, the more points, or the more value you're going to get, which is, I mean, we've been ingrained with this, right? I mean, have you experienced the same thing?
So, you see the person next to you in an exam, she's going on to her second paper and you're like, I've just got one paper and the third paper. I'm like, what else do I have to write? Oh gosh. You know, so you're absolutely right. Yes.
Yeah, I know the feeling exactly. You look at your neighbor, you're like, oh my gosh, I only have like half a page. Like, I better start writing some nonsense just to fill it up. Yeah, but that's a really big misconception that we have, right? So when it comes to content, one of the biggest tips that I can give is you don't have to make your speech ridiculously long, right? There's so much to be said for being concise and really just ensuring that your content is full of golden nuggets, right? You don't want to have a bunch of information there that doesn't serve a purpose, because what happens then is you end up, you know, with all this unnecessary information, which your audience is getting nothing from. And after a while, you're going to start to lose their attention, right? So if you have, instead of doing an hour speech, let's say your content is actually 20 minutes long. Let it be. Okay. Don't feel the pressure to hit a quota of like word count, and don't feel the pressure to hit a quota, right? I think it's really important to be real and be honest. And especially in like, if we're talking about everyday situations, right? The amount of Zoom meetings that people go into in a day is ridiculous, right? And people actually appreciate if your presentation can be done in 5 minutes, do it in five minutes. Don't like add in all this junk.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh my God, I agree.
Yeah. So I think that's something that's really underestimated, and it can be a huge value, right? To improve your communication and to become a better speaker. And so a tip that I can give you in terms of like delivery, right? In terms of your, you know, going back to the example of maybe you're not smiling or looking at the camera enough, right? If you watched yourself and you realize you roll your eyes a lot, then what you can do is for online, especially, you know, because I know you said nowadays we're all doing the stuff virtually. So one of the best ways you can make sure that you're actually paying attention to the camera is by actually placing a little post-it note right next to the camera and write the words down on it. Smile, right? A little yellow post-it note next to your camera. So your eyes will automatically shift there because it's a huge thing. You can't miss it. And every time you look into the camera, you're also going to be reminded to smile. So if you constantly find yourself like with that RBF face, this is going to really change everything. And, you know, it's really important to do this, right? Because virtual sessions are very hard to engage with people. You can't see people. Yeah. But people feel like right now, you know, if you were talking to the audience, right? Or let's say like in a Zoom call, right? If you actually look into the camera, people feel like you're actually looking at them. You're making eye contact, even though your eyes are looking into the lens, right? And this makes a huge difference, because the moment you shift your attention, right? And you start to roll your eyes and you look elsewhere, people don't feel the pressure to be invested in the conversation. Right? They don't feel the need to actually engage with you. So just doing a small thing like that and making sure that you try and spend at least 70% of the time looking into the camera lens is going to elevate your, you know, your communication skills significantly. So
Okay. So now that you brought up the virtual aspect, because my next question was going to be, what's the difference between public speaking virtually and physically, you know, like, because before this, I was very conscious about the way I stand, the way I hold the podium, the way I, where do I look in the audience? And, you know, all that made a huge difference to me. Eye contact with one person or with multiple people in the audience. Do I look at the screen behind me? Do I look at the computer in front of me? That's all in a physical event. But what's the difference between both virtual and physical? Like, one good tip was, like you said, looking at the camera, making sure you have eye contact. But anything else, the differences?
So I would say that for, you know, anything that's virtual, right, versus the big stage, right? So the big contrast here that you would really see is the fact that you still have to apply all the same principles. So that means, you know, when you talk about your content still has to be equally good. You still got to focus and make sure that you have good value proposition. You know, you've got good structure in your speech. That still applies. But the main distinction here lies in your delivery, right? So you're still going to ensure you have good expressions, body language, tonality, but how you do it is where it slightly differs, right? So let's talk about particularly body language. The most obvious thing right now that you'll notice is now we have a frame, right? You can only see like this part. So it's really hard to use the rest of your body, right? You know, if you wanted to do nice big gestures, that works on a stage, right? So if you're on a big stage, you want to remember the big stage, you complement that with big hand gestures because you're going to have people at the back of the room, and the larger the gestures, the more engaged, the more excited people are going to feel and be a part of it, right? It's going to complement your message. But if you're on a small frame like this, then one thing you can do, especially, I feel on the mobile phone, it's even smaller, but when you're on a laptop, right, it's slightly wider, you have a little bit more room to move. And what you can do is, let's say you're going to use your hands, right? Even if your hands, like right now, you can't see my hands, but if I'm going to use them right, to complement my message, I can still use them. So I'm going to make sure that if I'm talking about, like today I'm going to talk about two things. I'm going to talk about tonality and I'm going to talk about body language. As I use my hand gestures, I have to make sure that I'm very conscious of where the frame is, right? The last thing you want to do is have your hand like this. No one can see anything, right? Yeah. So you want to make sure that you're very aware, right? So every now and then, check in with your frame. You can still do your gestures to complement your message, but just make sure that it's actually visible, right? So if I'm going to say A and B, then I want to make sure that my audience can see it as well. Another example is if I'm going to do hand gestures on a big stage, right? I can, you know, I can use my gestures to explain that I'm going to talk about three things, right? But again, if I'm on a small frame, I want to bring all those movements and make them slightly more micro, right? So I'm going to talk about three things today. So do it next to your face. People can still see what you're doing. You're still able to complement your message, right? So it doesn't mean just because you're in a virtual world that you don't have to use your hand gestures at all, right? You can still use them to support your message. And the best thing is if you're doing a presentation that you are actually preparing in advance, then you can actually practice all of these gestures on screen beforehand, right? And again, it's going to make it a lot more engaging because without it, it then sometimes becomes very, very dull, right? So again, you're going to be able to use your body language to complement it even more. Hey, Bali, what's up?
Master Jedi.
He's so sweet.
All right, so at what age can someone groom themselves to start speaking in public? Because I started off actually very early when I was in primary school and my mom sent me for, we used to call it Shahrahan competitions, you know, like speech competitions. You know, so I used to go on stage, memorize this whole, like you said, whole 3-page speech and then go up and say the whole thing without having any papers. So I used to do that since I was like in standard 3, you know. So that sort of boosted my ability to go up on stage without having much stage fright. You know, like I know someone who was so afraid to even hold the mic. So what this person did was she bought, you know, in the Pasar Malam, you have all those 10 ringgit ones that you can, you know, toy mics. Yeah. And she sat in her house and she just held the mic to her face. Just alone in her own house, she did that and she started shivering. She couldn't because the mic was giving her so much of stage fright.
No.
So she started practicing on a daily basis just to boost up her confidence on holding the mic. And she finally went on to actually going up on stage and singing and things like that on her own. So, I mean, but everybody has their own journey. Yeah. So at what age do you think is a good age, like for a child or I mean, definitely I would say children, because when you're an adult, it's a little bit difficult to overturn certain features, that personalities that we have become. So at what age a child should go into public speaking, should be coached?
I think that's a really good question. And, you know, I'll also add on to the fact that yeah, I went to Chinese school, right? And I feel like, I'm not sure, I guess Kebangsaan school and like, you know, Chinese school, maybe it's the same as well. But like, we were really, I was terrified of my teachers. So I would, I think that's honestly
So we were not
caned all the time. So you never got like caned when you were in primary school?
No, I was too good a student. And never got caned.
So we would get caned for the silliest things, right? You lupa bawa buku, you get caned. If your fingernails are like, you can see the white part, you get caned. So we would basically get traumatized, right? And so, so I think part of that was what really suppressed this this intention or to speak up, right? So it was never there. This intention to speak up was never there. So I feel like, especially with our education system in Malaysia, where it is, I mean, I think a lot of us turned out perfectly fine, if not great, right?
Yeah.
But I do think that there's something to be said for encouraging kids at a younger age to speak up. So if you are in an environment like that, right, where like when I was in primary school, I would never dare in a million years to go on stage by myself and give a presentation. Never. Like I would just never do that. In fact, I would skip school sometimes in high school because my bahasa was so bad to avoid pembentangan. I'm not even kidding. So I would, you know, anyway, the bottom line is if that exists, right, that fear in school, or if you're not encouraged to share your opinion in class very often, the chances of having this follow us into adulthood is super high, right? So I would say, you know, the younger you are, the better, right? The earlier you can get started in feeling like it's perfectly fine to get out there, go on stage and do a performance, right? So start small, even if it's joining, like I said, the choir, that's like the stepping stone. You're at least going on stage, even if there's the comfort of numbers, right? So the younger you are, the better. And I think for parents, you know, if you want to get your kids involved, get them like even at home, like what you can do is make sure that when you're at the dinner table, ask them questions, ask them for their opinion, right? So that you get in the habit of actually sharing your ideas and articulating your thoughts. Because I think once you hit high school, then you have all that puberty kicks in, you become even more self-conscious. Yeah. And then it's really hard, you know, you have this inertia where it's really hard to get out of your shell. So yeah, the earlier you start, the better. And I think parents have a lot of ability to really nurture this from a young age. So in case they're not getting this in school, like do it at home for sure.
Absolutely. We have a comment in the public speaking, inborn talent or something one can learn. What are your thoughts?
Oh, what do you think, Dr. Rakhee? I know that you said you did public speaking when you were in standard three, like doing speeches. So was that like a natural ability that you had or?
So I would say, I mean, inborn talent, a bit difficult to say. I mean, nobody is genetically inclined to speak in public, but I would definitely say it's something that everybody can and should learn, like you said, you know. So I feel it's something that you can nurture at every age. I've got four children and every child has got a different ability to be able to speak. Like I've got one who loves to talk, you know, so she will say, "Mommy, I'm going to tell you a story today." And then the second one is like, "I'm going to sing, but I'm so shy to sing in front of y'all." You know, so there's every personality is different. So if you find someone that is a bit difficult to come out of the shell, so-called, see, I'm using my fingers. So I feel those ones need, like you said, need to be nurtured. Maybe you call them out on the table and say, "Would you like to tell me how your day went? What is something interesting you did today?" You know, so you nurture those ones even more. You pay a bit more attention to them. But there are some who just love to talk like me. You know, so you just go on talking and talking. So these are the ones that you have to tell them, okay, you got to come back down to the same line. And I don't. And so I feel it's not exactly an inborn talent, but it's something that you can learn. But there are some who are more than others, you know, you get what I mean? Some that like to more of an introvert, extrovert sort of thing. So some people love to do, some people not so much. So that's my take on it. What about you? What do you think?
I agree with you. I think that some people have the natural ability. I mean, I really do think there are gifted people, right? There are people with the gift of the gab who, you know, at a young age, and you can see this, right? I remember having like classmates who just were able to go in front of the class and tell the story, right? And it would just come naturally to them. And they would be able to articulate their thoughts pretty well. I was not one of those people. So I do believe that you can actually learn it, right? Because one thing is building the confidence, and then the other part is learning how to organize your thoughts, right? In a way where you can share it so that it's not just all up here, but you're able to actually, you know, communicate what it is that you mean in a manner that someone else can understand as well, right? And I think these, there are definitely techniques which help you and can build that up if you don't already have it. So yeah, so that's the good news. You can definitely learn it, Amy. And by the way, Amy, thank you for joining us today.
This is going to bring me, I like how Amy just led me to my next question, which is how do we reduce nervousness for those who so-called don't have the inborn talent? You know, like how do we go up on stage and like what I do is I prep myself. I prepare my intro and I prepare my exit. So I know that the moment I go on stage, this is what I'm going to say. And it, then the rest of it just rolls forward. And then I end it and I know, okay, I'm done. That's my own version. But what are your tips to reduce nervousness?
Oh, I love the fact that you mentioned, you know, your intro and your outro. I'm a firm believer in that as well, especially if you have a lot of content, right? The main thing you want to do, I'm going to pick up on that, is really, you want to make sure that you go in really strong and that you end on a strong note as well, right? So people remember the first impression, and then your last impression is also going to be a lasting one. So once you've done that, that definitely helps, like, build that confidence. But I would say the second thing also, I mean, one thing that I always do is, because sometimes if you're in a situation where maybe the stakes are super high and you're really nervous, maybe your superiors are there and you're really worried about everything going wrong. And the narrative that we usually tell ourselves at this point is, oh my gosh, what if I blank? Oh my gosh, what if I forget? Oh my gosh, what if my boss hates this? What if I get fired, right? So it's all about like, what if this happens to me, right? We end up focusing all this like negative energy and putting pressure on ourselves. So one thing I would suggest doing is really like flipping it, right? So you flip that around and you really focus on your audience. So let's say, for example, I go into a room, there's like 1,000 people in the audience, and the first thought is like, oh my gosh, there's so many people here. I don't want to embarrass myself. So instead of thinking like that, right, actually take a deep breath, look into the audience, right? Smile at people, right? And people will notice this about me all the time. Anytime I'm going to host an event, before I go on stage, I'm like, you can't wipe the smile off my face, right? Because I will keep looking at people and smiling. So what I'm doing is literally looking at people and thinking, I actually legit can't wait to meet everyone here in this room. I'm really excited to meet everybody. And instead of thinking, what are they going to think about my presentation? Go in with the mentality that I'm really excited to hear actually what they thought of it. I'm excited to see what their feedback is, you know, and what they thought of the presentation, what they thought of the ideas. And when you go in with this approach, this actually really helps you reframe your thoughts, right? Because now you're not saying, what if they reject my ideas? You're saying, I actually really genuinely want to know what people's opinions are. You're not letting their judgment tear you down. You're letting that build you up, because you're going in with the mentality that I want to build on what I have. So let's say, for example, you're representing your own brand and you're talking to a room full of people and you're worried people are going to hate the idea. So if you go in with this mentality, what happens then is, at the end of your presentation, your end goal is that, okay, cool. So if I, you know, if people didn't like my ideas, then I really want to know what they thought and how I can better it, right? So you're going to look from a perspective of advancing yourself, bettering it, being constructive. And that changes everything. Like, to me, that's one of the best ways to go about it. But you shift all that anxiety, putting that pressure on yourself, to shifting it out onto the audience and remembering that you're there to serve them. Right? It's not the other way around. And that makes a huge, huge difference. Hi, Drew. Hi, Kat. Let's see. What do we have?
We've got Kat that says, good day, Dr. Rakhee and Nadia. Have been the one who always raises her hands and goes spontaneously. Wonderful, Kat. Lucky to be chosen to voice out opinions, random thoughts, and post-event feedbacks. Hey, you're on my team, la. The talking, gabbing sort. I can't wait to get chosen. One more thing that my dad always told me when I first started doing speeches was, just imagine everybody's a potato sack.
Did it work for you?
So it's like, you know, so if you're so intimidated by the audience, because sometimes you feel intimidated by the faces. You know, they may not be very friendly faces. And he said, if you feel that way, just imagine everybody's a potato sack. So you won't be intimidated by anybody. So I said, okay, but what if I feel hungry and I want to eat french fries? Then he's like, okay, then imagine they're cauliflower sacks. I'm like, okay. The other thing is also what I do is sometimes when I do medical talks, so when I go up, I know I'm the only one in that room that has this particular knowledge. You know, so if I'm going to give out this knowledge to you, I'm like you said, I want to know what you feel. I want to know what you know. But I also know that I'm the one at this point that knows everything about this particular topic. So I think that helps me as well when I give talks, because I know that this is the topic of my expertise and I can go on talking about it. So I think that also helps. So if you're an entrepreneur and you're going to go up and talk about your product, you are the best person to know about your product. So you'll be the best person to be able to sell it, to be able to talk about it, to be able to give all the good points about it, you know. So I think that helps as well. So Nadia, do you have any final tips to everybody at all on public speaking and just anything random?
I think when it comes to especially squashing the fear of public speaking, I love the potato sack idea. And, you know, I think if you find a method that works for you, then stick to it, right? But I always, you know, I always share with my students three values, right? So I think it's really important to go in with, number one, having a humble mindset. So never letting your ego take over, right? Remembering that you're there to serve the audience. And this actually really helps to break down a barrier. So instead of thinking that everyone is here to like cheer and clap for me and love me, instead of thinking that because you're in the spotlight, think of it in terms of, I'm actually here to share. Like you said, I have valuable knowledge and I'm going to impart this, you know, to my audience. So that's the first thing that I always share. It's going to help your audience also connect with you, because you're not going to put your ego first. They're going to feel that you're actually here to help them, right? And it makes a huge difference. So the second thing that I always tell my students is, you know, besides being humble, is to really be open-minded. And that goes back again to, if you go in with the idea that I'm a human being, I can't possibly know everything, right? And so if you remember this, it eases the pressure. You don't feel this like sense of ridiculous expectation that you have in yourself. And this happens a lot when, let's say there's a Q&A at the end of the segment, right? Everyone worries, like, what if someone asks me a really difficult question that I can't answer? So when you're open-minded and you remember, at the end of the day, I'm a human being, there's always going to be someone who's more knowledgeable, who's more senior and more experienced than me. It's perfectly fine. So once you go in with this mentality as well, you take off that pressure. And you know, again, like at the end of the presentation, you're not there to get everyone 100% on your side. What you want to do is impart your message, get them to digest it, and it's up to your audience what they do with it. And if someone contradicts you at the end of your presentation and says, hey, but you know, what you said, that's not correct. This is the conclusion that I came to, right? So instead of being defensive, what it means is... you're going to, instead of defend your idea to the death and dismiss theirs, is that you're going to say, hey, actually, that's a really cool perspective. Thank you for sharing that. I really like to know how you came up with that. Maybe we can take that offline later on. So that's the big difference when you're open-minded versus when you feel like, I got to fight my idea to the death, right? Okay, so the third value that I always share with my students as well is enthusiasm. So if you go in with the mindset, that gung-ho mindset, you go on stage, you tell yourself, I'm excited to be here, I'm excited to share my message, that level of infectiousness, of enthusiasm is going to make the entire room electric, right? It's going to get everyone on your side. And your adrenaline, you know, will take over, your enthusiasm will take over. And I think that whole wave of confidence will also wash over you too. So these are three really important things to always remember whenever you go on stage. So be humble, you know, connect with your audience. Don't let your ego come first. You're there to serve people. Number two, to be open-minded and ease that pressure off. You don't have to know everything, but I'm not saying you shouldn't be prepared. You still have to be super prepared, right? And thirdly, of course, is go in with your enthusiasm. It's so easy to do, to get excited about something that you're talking about. Yeah. So I hope that helps. Yeah,
I think those were excellent points. I especially like the second one, because a lot of times when you go up on stage, one of the fears is someone asks you something that you have no idea or you're not sure what the answers are. And I think another way is also to say that at the moment, I don't have the answers with me, but I will definitely get back to you. Please leave your name and your email so that I can definitely get back to you once I do a little bit more research on that particular topic, you know. So always get back to the person who is, like I always, after my talks, I have like a quick break or, you know, tea session or things like that. And I always tell them, come and look for me. And, you know, if you're shy to ask me on stage, please come and look for me personally and ask me on the side as well. So giving them the opportunity to speak on a one-to-one basis as well. We've got Rohit who says Nadia is the best. And then we have Helena that says the tips here are so insightful. Please be safe this live session. So Helena, don't worry. It will be on my IGTV as well as my YouTube channel. And I will be tagging Nadia as well as her Articulate Community post. I mean, her group, her IG handles on the post itself. And we've got thanks, Vasha, Rakhee, great job. And Kat says to everyone here, you guys are incredible. Sophie says, be humble, be open-minded, passion and enthusiasm, great tips, or excellent. Always be open to receive criticisms, perceive them all as constructive. Absolutely. So I think one of the key things that you said was don't be defensive. And I find that a lot of people, maybe they're nurtured in a way that the moment you say something to them, they take it as a, they go automatically defensive. Yeah. You know? So for me, take a deep breath, take it as a constructive criticism, and you can always agree to disagree. Exactly. You may not have, you don't have to think exactly the same way as everybody in the world. So you can just agree to disagree. And like you said, let's take this perspective off stage and come and see me after that, you know? Yeah. So, and you don't look like you're fighting with a person on stage. So yeah. Thank you so much. But this has been really excellent. My most memorable experience was pitching on Asian discussion years back in front of H.E. Vicky Treadle. Wow.
Oh, wow. So fantastic. It was an ASEAN discussion for an ambassador, Vicky Treadle. That's, wow. Well done, Kat.
Wow.
Very cool.
Yes.
I wanted to add on to that. You know,
you're clapping in the micro thing.
Oh, sorry. Say that.
Sorry, what? Oh. No, I said I was clapping in the micro.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the micro.
Sorry, you want to say something?
No, yeah, I wanted to add on. I actually think you brought up a really good point. And it's something, again, that I also share with my students, because you said that you know, it's okay to disagree, right? So one thing that really helps you as well, like if you have a lot of nerves before a show, is to remember and to understand that there's actually three different groups of people that you will encounter in every setting, right? So you're always going to have, first of all, the group of people that loves you in a sense where they could be your friends, supporters. You know, your supporters. Then you have the group of people that, you know, they tengok muka je, they tak suka, you know, they see your face and they straight away decide, I don't like this person, right? But we all do, judge people, right? And then the third group of people are the ones who are like constantly on their phones, they don't even know you're on stage, right? So once
the connection one.
Yeah, exactly. No connection. They don't even know what's going on, right? So if we accept that there's going to be this group of people, right, that are in the audience, then it's up to us and it's our responsibility as a speaker, as a presenter, to make sure that our content is gold, right, of gold standard, the structure is there. And we also need to make sure it's our responsibility that the delivery side of things, your intonation, your body language, your engagement, you have to make sure that all of that is there, right? So if you are able to bring these two elements together, that's when the magic happens. And the goal is not to get everybody on your side. That's not the goal. Yeah. The goal we need to remember is to make sure that our message gets sent. People receive it, they understand it, they digest it. What they do with it is up to them, because no civilization, you know, like came out of one person. It came out of differences and disagreements and ideas, right? So I think when we accept that, it makes things a lot easier. Our goal is not to make sure that all three groups of people agree with us. We don't want that. But our job is to make sure that they wake up. So that group of people that were on their phones, we want to make sure through our delivery, our engagement, our body language, they actually wake up from their phone. They're like, hey, this is cool. This is interesting, right?
Yeah.
And the people that didn't like you at first, they may have judged you in the first opinion, but by the end of it, they'll be like, hey, that's a really compelling story. That's really cool ideas. And through your engagement, you might actually win them over. So that's our goal. I think people need to get off like this idea that we need to please everybody, because it's just not going to happen.
Right? It's not going to happen. we have to accept that behind, I begin to accept that behind 100 supporters, there will be one or two trolls, there will be one or two who are just out there to get you, but focus on the 100 who are there to support you, you know? So, oh, my hands were down, sorry. Focus on the 100 there to support you, you know? So I always feel, look on the bright side, and like you said, eye connection, just maintain eye connection, and everybody feels a lot more warmer when you give them eye connection, when you smile. Yeah. I do it all the time. So thank you so much, Nadia. I think this has been such an enjoyable conversation, and I've learned so much from you over the past couple of months following your IG pages. So if anybody has not followed Nadia Heng, there are two IG pages to follow. It's Nadia Heng as well as Articulate Community. And if you want to start coaching with her, if you feel that that's something that you want to do on a personal basis, I mean, this is a skill. It's a lifelong skill. So if you feel you're not up to par and you're too leche like me to just go and Google all these things, I mean, just sign up with Nadia and she's going to lead you along the right path, and she'll be able to, like you said, you know, you've got someone to monitor you and give you the constructive criticism that you need so that you can improve yourself. And when you go out there, you're going to rock the meeting. You're going to be like, whoa, Rakhee said that. Okay, you know? So on that note, thank you so much, Nadia. This has been wonderful.
Thank you.
You have a good night, and I hope to see you at another event. Sophie, you saw me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you so much for your time, Dr. Rakhee. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Absolutely.
I can't wait to connect with you again offline as well. And thank you guys for joining us. I hope you all found it helpful. See you. Bye.
Thank you.